Should we call this party to order here? Let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, on this Father's Day, we thank you for descending through the person and work of your Son into our lives to show us your great love for us. Lord, your love is not just for us, but it's for all the nations of the world. And so as we endeavor to study the book of Jonah, open our minds, just as, Lord, you are working to open Jonah's mind to see your love for not just the Israelites, but the true Israel, which is all the people who have faith and trust and hope in you, made so through your word sown in their lives. Jesus, your Son, it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Okay. So we're sort of, we're still in some introductory work on the book of Jonah, and where we made our way up to, I didn't get the chance to go back and review the video and see what my last known slide was with you. So if I'm starting on a new slide and it looks new to you, that's good. It's new to me too. So, but we're kind of picking up on the point last week that I made. That it just so happened that the men's Bible breakfast on Thursdays, we were in Acts chapter 10. And the topic in Acts chapter 10 intersected with the book of Jonah. And to shortcut that whole discussion, just by way of recap and to kind of find our way back into this presentation, is that both this presentation and Acts 10 were widening the scope of who has Jesus come for. He hasn't come for a certain, you know, tribe or nation or people or anything of that sort, but he's come for the whole world. Jesus died once for all, the scriptures teach us. And so kind of in the introductory portions of Dr. Lessing's presentation on Jonah here, he's driving towards that point. So on this slide, and I mean, I've told you this before we started, I hate reading slides to you, but I also want to make sure that we get his points across. So I'm going to be doing that and then expanding on them. So Israel's history is found not with a covenant at Sinai. So we think, you know, there at the giving of the Ten Commandments, God made a covenant with Israel. The 70 elders of Israel went up and ate with God. They vowed everything that God says that we are supposed to do, we will do this. And then, you know, like we always know, they didn't, right? And as I've drawn on the board probably more times than I can remember, this is important for us even now. We did this with the men's Bible breakfast on Thursdays when we were talking about millennialism and Zionism and sort of where things are at now. But you got to think in the Old Testament times, I can draw my little X here, and New Testament times. And if the crux of time is Christ, well, in the Old Testament, there's Abraham, and then that moves on to, you know, to Israel. It becomes Israel. And the Israelites were the ones to whom God gave his word, his law, and they were to be a light to the nations. It wasn't that they were just the special ones and they were only going to be the special ones always and forever. It was meant that by giving them this law at Sinai, they were to be to others a light to the nations. What made the Israelites unique and different was because they lived differently. Their God communicated with them, gave them victory, you know, like through the judges when we talked about this at the in the sermon with Samson, to give the Philistines over to them when they moved into the promised land. God was always and forever working through Israel, but Israel, as these guys up here rightly noted, failed always at every turn. And so what had to happen was God had to not make a new plan, but God had to, you know, continue in the plan that he always had in store, which was, as you read in the Old Testament lesson today, if you were at the first service, there would be a shoot from the tree of Israel that would be the one above all of them, and that would be Jesus. So Jesus would be Israel reduced to one person. Jesus becomes the true Israel at that crossroads of time. And now in the New Testament era, everyone who is in Christ is the new Israel. New Israel, God's treasured possession, is all who are in Christ. So that's you. But it's not just you, right? It's beyond you. It goes to others as well. So sort of in the strain of the kingdom of God parables that we get, like what I preached on for the gospel today. The kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed, right? Well, what's our job? Our job is to be ones who are scatterers of that seed so that others would be brought in through faith to be part of the new Israel, the ones that are pleasing to God. So that's kind of what you see right here. The origin of Israel's history is found not with the covenant at Sinai or the covenant with Abraham. The first covenant is one made with Noah and with all subsequent humanity, plus many animals besides. Animals will play a big part in the book of Jonah. Suddenly, the very God who seems to have winnowed out entire peoples and nations and tribes and families in choosing Israel is presented as the God who has always and all along been the compassionate, merciful God of Israel. But yes, also the God of the Edomites, the Ishmaelites, the Canaanites, the Amalekites, right? And the Mennonites. Just kidding. All the ites. In short, he's the God of everything and of everyone, and including the God of the Ninevites. So if you've been reading through the book of Jonah, you know, doing your homework on this, or if you remember the book of Jonah, if you've failed to read through it, you'll remember that it ends with a question, and it's God questioning Jonah, should I not care about these people? Jonah doesn't care about them. They're Ninevites. They're part of the Babylonians who overran the Israelites, and they are, by all accounts, enemies of God. And the question that they're sort of introducing here is our God, the one we worship, the God of just a certain group of people? Well, some people would say that that's how our God works. Well, you know, Jesus says in John 14:6, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Well, that's a very exclusive path to the Father, back to the Father. And it seems exclusive to people and seems exclusionary to people. Well, what about, you know, my neighbor friend who's a Mormon? What about my neighbor friend who's a Muslim or a Hindu? What about people who live on the other side of the planet? You mean to say that, you know, you just have to be a, you know, the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant and they're going to be the ones who are in heaven? No, this message is for all the nations. That's the message that the book of Jonah reveals. That's the message that the book, well, the chapter, Acts chapter 10 is all about, where Peter has the vision of the sheet that's lowered down from heaven and God gives the instruction to him, kill and eat, Peter. Don't call what God has made clean, unclean. What that is, that vision is about, that Peter understands it to be, is he goes to see Cornelius, a Roman centurion, and then Peter gets accused of by the Jews that, well, you're affiliating with Jews or with Gentiles. What are you doing? You know, and Peter says, what I see now, what's going on is God has revealed himself through Jesus in the person and work of Jesus for the world. And Jesus has, through his blood shed, redeemed the world. And this message and the Holy Spirit, as Peter saw in Acts chapter 10, was for the Gentiles as well, because the Spirit fell on Cornelius and his house. So it was meant to sort of spur Peter on. And then he gives a speech where he recounts this event with Cornelius. And he says, hey, I know now. I've got new knowledge. And this shouldn't be new knowledge for us, but in some ways it is. New knowledge for us, because we want the church to be people who look, you know, just like us and act just like us. And it's a little strange and out of our comfort zone when it doesn't look just like us or act just like us. Okay? So, moving on. Entering into the belly of this scant 48-verse story, we'll find ourselves spit out with a new history. It's a story of a people and their God that, like the Ninevites, has utterly been turned upside down. And if you were with me, I know not all of you that are here today were with me through the beginnings of this presentation, but Dr. Lessing, in this presentation that I'm using here, borrowing from, used the Lincoln's Gettysburg Address as his parallel to what's going on in the book of Jonah. And he used the Gettysburg Address to say, Lincoln, in that short speech that he gave at Gettysburg, took the nation's history and flipped it to give people a new view, try and move them beyond what had been happening up to that point and get them to see themselves as a new nation. And as a, think of the experiment that is America. It's a melting pot. You know, we're not just you know, people of Germanic heritage. And that's it, that's here. And we're like a new Germany here. You know, I mean, people would say that about German Lutherans. But we're wider than that. We're bigger than that as a nation, as a church. And so that's kind of where he's going in this when he says, what Lincoln did at Gettysburg, Jonah does for us as the people of God. In reframing our history, he gives us a new past to live with by bringing us back to Noah, because Noah essentially became the father of all these nations post-flood. So, and it's the story of a ship and people being saved through a flood like this. Well, that story changes our future then. What are the rapids that take us on a ride towards the life and times of Noah? One answer is found in the presence throughout the book of Jonah called a Noahic milieu. Say that three times fast. That. Just seeing if you're paying attention. There are numerous and, it would seem, intentional connections between the stories of Noah and the book of Jonah. Can you name some of them? I'll drink to that. Excuse me? What? Oh, ship.
Ship.
Okay. Wow, I wasn't sure what you were saying at me. Yes, yeah. Sailors of sorts, right? Sorry, just giving you a hard time. Yeah, the waters, going through the waters, salvation through the waters, right? Because Noah and his family were saved even having gone through the waters. What we tend to think of with Noah is all the people that were killed, all the people that died, all of creation that died in the flood, forgetting what God preserved through Noah and his family. He preserved faithfulness, right? And he preserved a future, part of which we are inheritors of, right? Well, similarly, through Jonah and the message that Jonah brings, he preserved a future. There was a ship. There was ship. There was a ship. There was water. There was death. Jonah was as good as dead. And yet he lived through to do the work that he was given to do. The oblique reference to Abraham, Avrim is Abraham's name, and we get the word Hebrew comes from Avrim in Hebrew as well. In Jonah 1:9 and in Jonah's recitation of a passage of Exodus in Jonah 4:2, convey that a steady stream runs back through the God at Mount Sinai, through the God of the first Ivri Hebrews, or the ones who are named after Abraham, and there's a confluence with the God of Noah, the primeval God of all creation. With this understanding and no other can we build enough consistency in our understanding of the book to comprehend Jonah's intense misery, namely that it is just like God to care for these violent and questionably repentant Ninevites, simply because God also made them and their animals. See, there's another parallel that we missed. What's in Jonah that's also in Noah? The animals on the ship. In Jonah, they show up because the king of Nineveh has the animals, even the people from the highest of them to the least of them, even down to their servant animals, if you will, are covered in sackcloth and ashes so that they too would repent. Okay? Simply because God made them and their animals, the last destination Jonah seeks is many nations. And Jonah, the word that God speaks to Jonah should be a judgment both to Jonah but also to us, that we should be looking not to see just a very narrow view of it, but a wider view of it. A technique that's garnered a great deal of recent notoriety in the world of popular music is known as sampling. Sampling involves taking snippets of other artists' songs, weaving them into a new song. The technique is, in fact, nothing new. Consider the lyrics of the well-known patriotic song, I should have held off until July, I guess. You're a Grand Old Flag, which samples the much older song, Auld Lang Syne. You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag. Forever in peace may you wave. You're the emblem of the land I love, the home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats out true neath the red, white, and blue. Where there's never a boast or brag, should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag. So it's being sampled. What he's making the point of here is that the book of Jonah is sampling from Noah. Such samples act as accents to the song itself, as well as they brings in the musical and effective associations that listeners have with those songs being sampled. Sampling is a frequent practice in rap and hip-hop music. Its role explained by daddy-o of the group Stetsasonic. Never heard of them. But quote, we sometimes use words, recontextualization or revivification, that means to bring life again to something, but it makes the same, means the same thing, which means to take something old and make it new again. The strong point of what sampling does for us as a music form is to establish some soul groove and some old funk that's lost with today's music. I've never thought of funk and Jonah together, but this is my professor. All such samplings represent a kind of musical intertextuality. I'll tell you that the Bible does this frequently, this sampling from of old. Think of the Gospel of Matthew with me, if you will. Internal evidences, I'm going to take you on a side trip here for a minute. Internal evidences found in the Gospel of Matthew clue us into the idea, or scholars into the idea, that Matthew was a disgraced former rabbi. One of the reasons that that gets said about Matthew is that of the four Gospels, Matthew, more than the other three Gospel writers, samples from the Old Testament. So I'll give you some examples of this if you've got your Bible. It's a Bible study, so hopefully you do. Turn to the Gospel of Matthew with me. And we're going to just pick up in chapter 1. And one example, I'm going to give you a couple of examples just in a short window here. So the birth of Jesus Christ begins at verse 18. So there's genealogies that tie Jesus back to Adam. But you go to the birth of Christ. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Now, skip ahead. He gives a summary of the angelic vision to Mary, but also to Joseph in a dream. And then look at verse 22. It says, all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, God with us. So he's sampling from Old Testament writings, and he's recontextualizing them to say, this was written in a place and in a time, but it had meaning when applied to the person and work of Jesus when he came. These Old Testament prophecies were about Jesus, but we have to reintroduce them to you, get them back in the forefront of your mind to help you see that what they were written about back then was about what's happening, or in Matthew's case, what has just happened among us. We'll now skip to chapter 2, the wise men. And you see in verse 5. They told him, in Bethlehem of Judea is where this child is to be found, for so it is written by the prophet. And you see Matthew sample again from the Old Testament. And the reason that it's not doing it in the way like the hip-hop example that he gives or the Auld Lang Syne is used in another song. He's sampling from the Old Testament and he's recontextualizing it so that you can see that all these things that were written about Jesus. And Matthew does this more than any other gospel writer, which that gives us, we know who Matthew is given the gospel. He's Levi the tax collector, and we know what we think about tax collectors, right? You know, and it's one reason I think is sort of interesting whenever Matthew talks about the greatest sinners in the generation, treat him as a Gentile or as a tax collector. Why? Because he's the worst kind of human being that there is. So Matthew, this is again one of the things that Matthew knows all these Old Testament lessons, and he's taking them and making application to Jesus, and he does it more than any other gospel writer, sampling from the Old Testament, which reveals his knowledge of the Old Testament, his potentially rabbinic knowledge of it, but because he's not said that he's a rabbi, instead he's a tax collector, which is a reprehensible job by the Jews, well, that suddenly then means he's the lowest form of life, and anyone who does what he does is also the lowest form of life. So it's a side point, but scholars think that Matthew was disgraced for some reason. We don't know why. We don't even know that that's fact, but it's helpful the way Matthew's gospel is written to help us see through the Old Testament eyes who Jesus is and what he's come to do. And it comes through what I'm sort of terming sampling right here. Where was I in here? It brings additional potentially meaningful dimensions to the musical experience. So in the case of Your Grand Old Flag, the use of "Should Auld Acquaintance Be Forgot" brings to a musical affirmation of patriotism the feeling of community by evoking a song traditionally sung by close friends and family singing in the new year together. Or was it not Kenny Loggins? Who's the other guy that had the Auld Lang Syne song in the 70s, soft rock? No, I shouldn't have brought it out since I can't see. Dan Fogelberg. Remember the Dan Fogelberg song?
Oh, yeah.
Same Auld Lang Syne. When he meets the gal in the grocery store checkout line. Am I the only one who remembers songs from the 70s in here? You were busy? I don't have my phone. I can't play it. Am I seriously the only one that knows that song? Same Auld Lang Syne? I got to get some new stuff. So the book of Jonah samples the account of Noah found in the book of Genesis. And although the book of Jonah can be appreciated without an awareness of these samples, a recognition of the Noahic connections that sprinkle throughout the story take this convention to one destination, which is many nations. Many nations come from the one man, Noah and his family. What follows here is a list of phrases, characters, and images found in the stories of Noah drawn from Genesis 5:28 to 10:32 that will find resonance within the book of Jonah. So if you've been doing your homework and reading through the book of Jonah each week at least once, maybe some of this will ring true. If not, then please do this week and maybe look for some of these references that are brought in here. Oh, yes.
I have a question.
Yeah. Not off the top of my head that I can think of. Yeah, there may be some, why I say not off the top of my head, there may be some pseudepigraphal writings that have some stuff like that, that those would have been written by, you know, rabbis, teachers of old, but they're not either A, validated, or B, don't have some sort of connection to testify to Jesus, which is why they're not included in the scriptures. But not off the top of my head can I think of anything. Well, you know, now that you say that, though, this would be a little bit of a, because I took you to Matthew, let's go back if you still have your Bibles open to that, because I told you there's the genealogical records in Matthew. The risk to look to these is, I should note that the way they're presented here in Matthew, and without going into a full Bible study on Matthew, the genealogical records here. So let's go Matthew 1:1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. So Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah and his father Perez and Zerah by Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Amminadab, Amminadab the father of Nahshon, Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, Obed the father of Jesse, Jesse the father of David the king. So there's 14 generations there. Then there's another section of 14 generations. David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. Solomon, the father of Rehoboam. Rehoboam, the father of Abijah. Abijah, the father of Asaph. Asaph, the father of Jehoshaphat. Jumping Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat, the father of Joram. Joram and Jehoshaphat, the father of... And Joram, the father of Uzziah. Uzziah, the father of Jotham. Jotham, the father of Ahaz. Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah. Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh. Manasseh, the father of Amos. Amos, the father of Josiah. Josiah, the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. So you see what's happening is we're going backwards in time, right? After the deportation to Babylon, I'm sorry, we're going forwards. What am I saying? This one only goes back as far as Abraham. But when you look at a genealogy like that, we can only pick up with Abraham, who came long after Noah, right? And even Abraham didn't write the Pentateuch. Moses wrote the Pentateuch. So Abraham was a precursor to that. So there may be some genealogical records, but when I point this out to you to show how these work, they do 14 generations three times over, okay, is what they do right there. It says, so all the generations of Abraham to David were 14 generations, from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations, and from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. Well, faulty math has been done on the basis of this because what they're doing is they're picking out important figures, right? That's how Matthew does this. They're picking out the key figures in that time. So there may have likely been more than 14 generations that existed in each of these pieces. So to try and reestablish something biblically and genealogically like that, that's where we get the young earth theories with the 6,000-year-old earth, is through some faulty genealogical records. When reality would say, and this is what I remember from being taught at seminary, the best that we could ascertain from the Bible, genealogically speaking, is the earth is, you know, 25 to 50,000 years old by going strictly off of genealogies. And even that's faulty. 50,000. Yeah. But then it brings up, I'm starting a whole new can of worms here. Brings up, the whole thing would be, can God create with the semblance of age because God is outside of time? So if he called things into existence, could he have called it into existence with the semblance of age, right? So that, yeah. So anyway.
Well, the answer is no.
Yeah, the answer is, well, I'm not going to say a definitive no because there may likely be some genealogical records, but I can't. Yeah. That's as close as I could get you to something, and it only goes back as far as Abraham. So there are some in Genesis, though. Yeah. Yeah, 10. It's chapter 10. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and Josephus was a Jewish rabbi who became a historian that traveled with Roman armies. So Josephus, and that's what I said, without doing a little bit of, you know, research, I'm not saying that there isn't, but nothing that I'm aware of right off the top of my head. There's not a lot that's on the top of my head anymore or on my top lip anymore. Twenty-five to 50,000 years old is what my professor at seminary taught in Exodus and the Torah.
Does that mean creation of man or just?
Well, that all happened in a six-day span, the creation of the heavens. If you read the Genesis record, we hold that that happened in 6 days, a six-day creation. So the man was created with the woman on the sixth day. So that would be all the way back to creation so far as it can be ascertained biblically, using genealogical records. And where they got the 6,000 years was they would look at, like, you know, Methuselah. They would look at all those records. I believe it's Genesis 10 where they've got all these people and their ages, and they're making it as if it's like a contiguous line of people down through the family. Whereas what I was trying to demonstrate by showing you Matthew is, while it shows 14, 14, and 14 generations, it's not necessarily accurate. They're giving you 14 of the key generations between each, you know, key person or key connection of Jesus back to Abraham and the Abrahamic covenant. So. Yes. This is why we only live, you know, Moses says in Psalm 90, 70 or by reason of strength, 80. And I just have 3 kids. And then they wear you out. So here are the echoes in Jonah. 120 years. That's the length of time. It's in Genesis 6:3, but that's the length of time allotted to mortal life by Yahweh. It's also how many thousands of people are in Nineveh at the story's end, is 120,000. Yahweh was sorry, it said in Genesis 6:6. Now, what's he sorry about in Genesis 6:6? He was sorry that he had made man. It grieved him in his heart that he had made man on the earth, and so God set about to destroy man from the earth. Literally, Yahweh repented that he had made humankind. That's something. Relenting and repenting is what the Ninevites bank on and what Jonah is upset with Yahweh for doing in Jonah 3 and 4. So what does Yahweh do? He says, yet 40 days and Nineveh will be overturned. That's the sermon. It's a law gospel sermon. The law is Nineveh will be overturned. The gospel is there's still time. And should you turn away from your sinful ways, God will relent from this disaster that he has stored up for you. In Genesis 6, 7, the people were together with animals. This phrase occurs throughout the Noah stories. The book of Jonah is remarkable for its very deliberate inclusion of animals along with people, both in how the Ninevites repent and in how God presents his final question to Jonah. Turn in your Bibles with me to the end of the book of Jonah. And you'll see that question in there. Verse 11 of chapter 4. This is God's. Well, let's go to 10. The Lord said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor. You did not make it grow, which there's a connection to Mark today. The Mark gospel from Mark 4:26 is we sow the seed, but God is the one who makes it grow. The farmer doesn't know how to do it. He knows not how, it says in Mark 4. But God is the one who made it grow. From when it came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city of which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle. Beef, it's what's for dinner. Ah, yummy. So God includes the animals in there as something that he has redeemed. Everything that is made is redeemed by God. There's violence in Genesis 6:11. It's the reason given for God's decision to destroy the earth. I don't know how much you know about. If you want to turn back to Genesis 6, let's do that, and I'll show you a little bit of this. This is the beginning of the Noah story. And you know, we read it, and it's a Bible story we learn in Sunday school, and then we sort of forget about it. Or it even seems, in some ways, to us to be sort of fairy tale-esque, you know? Well, it's Noah, and the reason it is because we have the Fisher-Price ark, and we have the plastic animals that you can play with in the Fisher-Price ark, and you think of it as just like a toy story, you know, something that you play within, but when you think about what was going on, it's a very real story. It's listed as a part of our scriptures. It's something that I suppose some people would say, would call it, you know, lamentable. As Christians, or almost embarrassing, because, you know, how does this work? Does God really do this, or is this sort of just a fairy tale fable that we're supposed to take away? So if you start at chapter 6, verse 1, when man began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of man were attractive, and they took as their wives any as they chose. Well, what does that mean? Whole doctoral dissertations have been written about the first several verses in Genesis chapter 6. Then the Lord said, my spirit shall not abide in man forever, for his flesh, his days shall be 120 years. There's that reference. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of man, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. Now, how many of you guys have ever seen the internet stuff about the giant skeletons that have been unearthed? Don't be afraid to tell me that you've seen this stuff. Yeah. What do you think of that stuff? And they show pictures of people standing next to these giant skeletons. And oh, AI. AI. I thought you were just saying AI. AI. You know, AI. I watch the phones too. AI. If you see pictures of it, how do you know the pictures are real? Yeah. So that's one of the problems with artificial intelligence and the creation of some of these images and fake news and all that stuff. But just a word of quick explanation here. A lot of people will go, well, this is, you know, if you watch the History Channel and you get Ancient Aliens, anybody watch that garbage? Okay, stop watching it. Okay. What a lot of this is. So sons of God, What they mean when this is written here is it's a Hebrew idiom, sons of God. And it's meant like people who are purporting themselves to be like gods. Remember what the first sin was in the book of Genesis in chapter 3. What was the sin that Adam and Eve entered into? Was it the eating of the fruit? No, it was their desire of what they would get by eating the fruit, which was to be, instead of being a creature that God created, it was to be like God, or to be on par with God, or even to be over God, to be the God, that they get to decide right from wrong, good from bad. Before they had done this, everything that God gave was all good. Anything that God gave to them was all good. But now, stepping out from their creatureliness, they wanted to be like God. Well, that's what was going on in the time when people began to multiply on the face of the earth. The sins of the people were multiplying on the face of the earth. People who were wanting to be in the place of God and standing in the place of God and making decisions for themselves and wanting to go their own route. And even going so far as to purport themselves as gods. So when you study the gods of the ancient Near East, like we had to do in seminary for Exodus and the Torah class, what you find, and this I'll give you the easy ones that you guys know. Pharaoh in Egypt. How did Pharaoh purport himself? Like a god. A sun god in this case. Yeah, not a sun, S-O-N, but the S-U-N, Ra, the sun god. This was pretty typical amongst the nations that God was going to destroy because they weren't following his words. Israel was to be a light to these nations to show them who the true God was. And who's the true God? Not you. Yahweh is the true God. So people that were coming up, you know, before the face of God, these people saw the daughters of man were attractive. And everybody reads into that and they go, well, it must have been aliens that came and they impregnated women on earth and that's how they populated the earth. And I would say, stop with that stuff. It's not what the Bible is saying. They took as their wives any as they chose. The Lord said, my spirit will not abide in man forever. And then this word, the Nephilim, is a word that we don't know what it means. And that's where I said doctoral dissertations have been written on this, that we just have no way to put back together what this means. But again, when it... Thugs. They're just people that were an affront to God. Thugs? Nephilim, thugs, tyrants, sons of God. See note on the mighty men of renown. First, nobility of the world was a group of tyrants who were admired nonetheless. They were sinners ripe for judgment in God's eyes. So all we have to know is that there was corruption on the earth, and God set about to destroy the corrupt stuff that was going on the earth. And then he sets the rainbow in the sky, and he says, I'm not going to do that again. Which, you know, we're just finishing up Pride Month here, and they've adopted the flag, you know, as their marching orders. And the irony that stands behind that is the flag is actually a sign of God's grace and peace and his forgiveness, his free gift of forgiveness. The irony is that they don't see what they're doing, these people that march behind the pride flag, as being sinful or as an affront before God. And if it's not a sin, guess what they don't need? They don't need forgiveness. They don't need a savior. And God is freely giving them forgiveness. They just don't want it. So there's a whole bunch of irony in this whole pride stuff that's going on right now. But it's some of the same stuff, I would tell you, that got up in the grills of God back in Genesis 6 when he chose to destroy the earth. It's just that God made a covenant never to do that again. So the reason, we die through water still. We die through water still. So we're going to die through the baptismal waters to rise to new life again, right? But there is a promise in the scriptures that there's going to come an end to this when Jesus returns. Pride is the ultimate sin. Not to go down another weird path today, all of places that I never expected to go today, but why not? If you do some reading in the Old Testament pseudepigrapha, there's a book called the Book of Adam, which gives the origin story of Satan. And Satan's origin story... And what makes, I mean, we talk about this and think like Marvel Comics origin stories. This isn't what I'm talking about. Now, it's not validated because it's not in Scripture, but the way the story goes is that Satan was the first of God's heavenly creatures that were created, most beautiful amongst the heavenly creatures, second only to the Trinitarian Godhead itself. So Satan was in the highest of orders amongst the angelic realm, and second only in his beauty to God, and didn't want to play second fiddle to the Trinitarian Godhead. He wanted to be in charge. And so that's why he got booted out of heaven, and he was given much power on the earth. And you can read about that in Revelation 12, how Satan was kicked out of heaven. And that it was his pride that got him kicked out of heaven. So what does he try to do with the man and the woman then in Genesis 3? He tries to rub off with his pride and get them to have a similar pride. And what's the pride? We don't want to be second fiddle to God. We want to be on par with God. It's the same sin that this book of the Pseudepigrapha speaks about, how Satan got kicked out of heaven is how man got kicked out of heaven. So can I say that it's true? I can't. I don't know. But at the same time, I would tell you it holds water theologically. And the interesting thing is God is always and forever shaming Satan. Right? So think of the book of Job. You think of the beginning of the book of Job, Job 1:8 says, Satan was traveling around with the sons of God, walking up and down on the earth and to and fro on it. And he presents himself before God. And God says to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? There's none like him in all the earth. Why would God do such a thing? Because Satan thinks he's got the upper hand. I can get this guy to fall. I can get him, you know, to curse God. But what God does with Satan is, or what God does with Job is, he's constantly giving his Holy Spirit to make a right confession, including in Job 19, he confesses, I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last I shall see him with my own two eyes, in the flesh I shall see him. Job makes a good confession that he's got a Redeemer. That's the way that we're going to live, right? And God is constantly giving his Holy Spirit to Job to rebuff Satan's attacks on Job. And what's happening is God is knocking down Satan's pride. Satan is always and forever going to lose. And that's the life of the Christian. That's you. That's where it comes down to today. What do you do when you're tempted to sin? Do you go your own way? Do you be a God unto yourself and decide what you think is right or wrong? Or do you go the way God would have you go? Hopefully. Yeah, that's what I've said. Being a Christian is at the same time the easiest job you'll ever do and the hardest job you'll ever do. It's easy because all you have to do is what God told you. So when your neighbor sins against you and you're offended by that, what should you do?
Scream at him.
That's just how it went in the office when we were together. What should you do? Should you forgive your neighbor? You should forgive as you've been forgiven. That's what the Bible teaches, right? And if you did so, you would be a light to other people. People would see you and go, well, what makes them forgive somebody even though they've been wrong? Well, I follow the word of the Lord. That's what. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Right? So I don't need to take vengeance. I don't need to be angry with that person. They've been forgiven by God, so why shouldn't I forgive them? That's what you should do. But then try and forgive that person that's wronged you. That's no fun. So it's hard. It's easy to do because it just tells us what we should do. It's hard to do because it tells us what we should do, and it's hard to do it, right? But in doing so, if you rebuff the attacks of Satan and you forgive this person, even though it seems impossible for you to do so, guess who's glorified? God is glorified. If you hold a grudge against the person, you neglect to forgive them, and you hold their sins against them, who gets glorified? Satan does. And you're not living according to the way God's called you to live. So it becomes a terrible thing that happens. Whew. How did we get here? Let's go back to the screens in Jonah. I want to get through some of this so we can get into the text of Jonah, because there's great stuff on that. There's violence that's going on. So that's the reason given for God's decision to destroy the earth. There's evil that's going on throughout the book of Jonah. And it's one of the framing words, the evil. Not just the evil of the people of Nineveh, but the evil of Jonah, because Jonah initially goes against God's will and word. The ark in Genesis 6:14 is the means that God provides for Noah, for his protection, his family, and all the animals from the impending flood. There's a connection between the ark and the ship that Jonah boards. And even more so with the great fish, which turns out to be the vessel that God provides Jonah that protects him from the overwhelming floodwaters. I probably told you this before in the sanctuary, but you know, churches were designed with the woodwork up in the ceilings. And ours has the two great big beams that go through there. Like at some of the big churches that I've been to, like European churches, the seminary chapel, for instance, it's all woodwork ceilings like this with framework that goes between the pillars over it. And it's meant to look like an upside down ship. Like if you were to be looking into a ship, well, when you're in the sanctuary of the church, that's like being on the ark, like Noah was on the ark, because it was through being on the ark that people were saved, right? And that's where he's connecting to Jonah here. It was while he was on the ship, he was safe, but then they chucked him off the ship. Now he's in the ark of the belly of the fish that swallowed him to protect him. And when you're in a sanctuary of a church like that, that's one way the architecture of a church can reinforce some of the truths of what's going on, that you're saved through the ark of the church, that you're in the church and therefore you're safe. 40 days and 40 nights, that's how long they were on the, that it rained in Genesis 7:4. This is the period of time that the rains last, destroying all human and animal life that is not with Noah in the ark. Similarly, this is the amount of time from the moment of Jonah's prophecy until Nineveh is to be overturned or turned upside down. The association of 40 days as a period for destruction is a link between these two stories. You know, you can get a lot of numerology in the Bible. You know, think of some other 40s. Yeah, Egypt, 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. 40 days of temptation in the wilderness. Yeah, roughly. Yeah, 70 AD. So they figure Jesus' crucifixion like 33, so roughly 40 years, but close. Yeah. I'm thankful none of you, since we were using hip-hop as an example before, weren't thinking 40-ouncers. although proud moment, proud dad moment here, my son in the back is going. flood of waters, the great and the deep in Genesis 7. These are two equivalent phrases for the watery torrent that drowns creation in the Genesis story. In the psalmic prayer that Jonah utters in chapter 2, these terms of the watery great deep. It's another one is, you guys have said this word a lot and maybe didn't know what you were saying. You guys ever remember the word Sheol? You'll read it a lot in the Psalms. You know, Sheol is a place of the unknown or the deep. And a couple of quick tie-ins, and this will be a good stopping point when we get through. The word great occurs frequently in both texts. Gadol is the Hebrew word for it, and it's in both the Noahic or the Genesis texts and the Jonah text. But I want to go back to point 8 with Sheol for just a moment. You guys don't know it, but when they talk about, you know, the darkness of Sheol covered me, they're talking about the deep, places of the deep. In the Hebrew mindset, I think I've done this before in the men's Bible group, but I don't know that I've ever done it in here. The Hebrew mindset, if you go to the creation story in Genesis, everything was water. Like all of the firmament was water. So the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters, it says. The Hebrew word is mayim for waters. The Hebrew word for the heavens is shamayim. So they're intricately related. So to the Hebrew, they would look up and they would see a blue sky. And what's making the sky blue? It was water. They would look down, they'd look to the sea. And what would they see? They would see blue in the sea and in the lakes, and they would say, well, that's water. They would dig a hole in the ground for a well, and what if they dug deep enough, what would they find? Water. So to them, everything in the firmaments was water. And when God did his creative work, what he did was he carved out a gap in between the waters. Think of, you know, giving the kids a bath in the bathtub when you have the Tupperware. Because all of our Tupperware, we've lost the lids to it, so now all Tupperware is good for is for rinsing the kid's head in the tub, right, when they're babies. So when you take that thing and you turn it upside down and you put it in the tub, what stays in underneath the Tupperware? There's air in there, and that's kind of the way they thought about creation, is that when God made a separation or an expanse between the shamayim and the mayim, He carved out a space in between, and that's where creation was placed. That's the way they thought, right? So the waters were a place that were a place of the unknown. The heavens were the unknown places. The deep places in the earth, unknown places, right? And that's where they get this terminology, Sheol. The other last thing I'll give you here is that's why, turn with me to Revelation 20, and we'll close with that. What did Jesus do? Pop quiz while I'm getting you to Revelation 20. What did Jesus do with his disciples after he was raised from the dead before he ascended into heaven? They were out fishing, and he was there on the beach. And what did he do? He ate. What did he do with them when he was in the upper room with them? He ate, but he also did what? He showed them his hands, his side, and his feet. The feet thing is important because they had an idea of the paranormal or ghosts and ideas of the spirit world, but if you could see one's feet, then you knew they weren't a ghost. Or if you could see them eat, you knew they weren't a ghost. So when Jesus was walking on the water out to the ship that was being tossed around when the disciples went ahead of him, they could see him walking on the water. What's the significance of his walking? He has mastery over the deep, over the waters, and he's not a ghost. Those are the two big things that are there. So if you look at Revelation 20, picking up at verse 11, I saw a great white throne, him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away. There was no place found for them. I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what they had done. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. So there was something unique about the sea because it had a connection to Sheol. Is what happens when a boat sails away from port and never makes it to where it was intended to go? It's sunk and the people go to the deep, and there's no body to prove that they're dead, so they become spirits. Davy Jones' locker, right? So this whole Sheol thing is about, it's an unknown place, it's hell, it's the deep, and it's connected to Jonah because Jonah goes through hell to bring heaven, to bring forgiveness, to bring life, salvation, and a connection to our God. So, that makes sense? Did I tie that up enough? I did it quickly, but. Yeah, I'll hold these till the next time. This is a great place to pick up. Read through the book of Jonah. If you want, read through Genesis 6, 7, and 8, and you'll see some of the connections between the two. And hopefully we'll get through some of this and get into the meat of Jonah then. Thanks, guys. Sorry I had to hurry.